Welcome, welcome, everybody. It's great to see so many here. Spring is in the air, but I'm a little worried about tomorrow. Anyway, I like to always start by thanking Friends of Concordia. Their support makes these programs possible. And soon, you will be receiving our annual solicitation letter. And I hope if you're not a friend, that you will join us. And if you are a friend, that you will renew your membership. Because your dollars are really critical to these programs being carried out. So I thank you and I hope you will join us. Now, as many of you know, March is Women's History Month. And the theme this year is weaving the stories of women's lives. And what a story Regina Calcaterra weaves in her memoir, Etched in Sand. It informs and inspires and reveals Ms. Calcaterra to be an exceptionally strong role model whose story challenges stereotypes and upends social assumptions about foster children, homelessness, and families. I've asked Jennifer Pinto, director of Concordia's social work program, to introduce tonight's speaker. Professor Pinto is a Concordia graduate. She earned her master's in social work from Fordham University, and she is a licensed social worker. She teaches courses in social welfare, ethical decision making, and mentors her students, preparing them for a profession in social work. Currently, 43 students are enrolled in the program. Many of them are here tonight, and I thank you for joining us. I think you'll be very glad you did. Her work focuses on behavioral intervention training, parent training, and advocacy for client systems. Intervention, training, and advocacy, which, as Etched in Sand makes abundantly clear, makes a difference in the lives of children and their families. Please welcome Jennifer Pinto.
But I would like to just take a minute to recognize Ellen D. St. Fowl. Tonight is a little bittersweet. This is her last Books and Coffee and her last community event with us. She is leaving the college. Actually, today is her last day. Ellen has brought to us, since she came here in the fall of 2011, over 40 distinguished guest speakers. She has been a gracious hostess to over 600 people between the community dinners and the Georgian dinners at Dr. George's home. And she not only is a great colleague, but she's a dear friend to all of us. So I'd like to just take this moment to thank Ellen for all her time. Thank you.
Thank you all for coming this evening. I want to take a moment to introduce our author tonight, and it's my pleasure to introduce Regina Calcaterra to Concordia. Since its publication by HarperCollins in August 2013, Etched in Sand has captured audiences everywhere, appearing on both the New York Times and the Wall Street Journal bestseller lists. Readers and critics alike have hailed Etched in Sand, proclaiming it riveting, courageous, fascinating, and unforgettable. Etched in Sand is a remarkable story of resiliency, and it has a powerful lesson for those of us in the social work profession. Our work is dedicated to supporting and protecting the well-being of children and families. It is almost unimaginable to think, amidst the wealth and luxury we often associate with Long Island, that Ms. Calcaterra and her four siblings struggled with abandonment, abuse, hunger, and homelessness. But as social workers, we know no place or person is immune to the struggles with mental health, financial insecurity, and the pressures of providing for a family. What Ms. Calcaterra's book does is make us look closely past our own assumptions and see how these unbelievable circumstances can occur. Without blame or recrimination, she shows us the tremendous impact each of us has on a child's life, how simple an act of kindness can provide hope to sustain a child, enabling her to forge ahead and succeed in life. This is why our work is important. Studies have shown resiliency more than any other attribute, along with strong social support and a community, allows individuals to succeed. Ms. Calcaterra and her siblings relied on one another to help raise each other. Their bond was strong, and they are a remarkable example of this resiliency. But even with that bond, the situation was bigger than five children could manage. It required great support, and that is where social workers play the most critical role. Our job is to intercede, identify needs, and provide the appropriate care and necessary support. We are there to alleviate the struggle and offer hope. Etched in sand reaffirms that hope, our professional purpose for social workers. As we meet her today, a graduate of SUNY New Paltz and Seton Hall University School of Law, a successful lawyer and a best-selling author, it is easy to forget the little girl who was hungry, homeless, and abused. But Regina Calcaterra will not let us. She has become a passionate advocate for the adoption of older foster care children, and Etched in Sand continues to instruct and inspire, leaving a lasting impression on her readers. Please join me in welcoming Regina Calcaterra to Concordia.
Thank you so much, Jennifer. That was a very, very kind introduction. I really appreciate it. And I want to thank Ellen and Jennifer for putting together the program tonight and for inviting me here. As an author, having an opportunity to speak to a college and a community around a college is pretty significant, and it's not something many authors, it's not an opportunity that many authors are offered, so I'm honored that I was actually invited here to speak to you. So thank you both for putting together this program tonight. And I want to thank a series of people also for inviting me here. That would be President George and the faculty and the administration and the students, because I tend to believe you probably had a little bit to do with this, since many of you are reading the books in the social work class. So what I'd first like to do is basically get a sense of who's here this evening. And so just by a show of hands, if you could let me know. So where are our students from Concordia? You're all sitting in the back, I see. We've got one brave soul up front. Okay, can't say I didn't do the same when I was you. Faculty and administration of Concordia. Faculty, staff, and administration, got a few. So is everyone here from the greater Bronxville community? Yes. Everyone else? What greater Westchester community? Wow, this is fabulous. So this is great, so you really did bring in folks from the community, so I greatly appreciate that as well. Now let me ask, who's here from book clubs? Okay, I suspected there were a few. Well, thank you all for being here tonight, and I especially want to thank the students of Concordia, because I understand what's on your plate. I mean, you're going to school, and you're not only attending classes, but you're studying. Some of you may be working, and you also have family obligations. And the fact that you actually took time out of your schedule to do something not related to any of those other obligations that you have, and the thing that you did do was come and listen to me tonight, I do hope that I don't disappoint you, and I expect you to leave here inspired, and that is my goal tonight. And I'm looking up at you, but I do know that this one you're also sitting in the front seat. So thanks so much for being here. So what I'm first going to do is tell you about the book, about Etched in Sand, for those who haven't had an opportunity to read it, and a little bit more insight into the story than what's necessarily in the pages. Then the second thing I will share with you is why I wrote the book, because there were two reasons. And then I'll share with you the impact the book has had, because it really has a tremendous amount of impact, more than I ever expected. And then we will open it up to Q&A. And then after that, then we go outside for a book signing. So if you brought a book with you, I will gladly sign it. But if you haven't and you're interested in purchasing one, you'll be able to do that outside tonight. So thank you again for being here. So the story of Etched in Sand is about my siblings and I. I was one of five, born to my mother who was mentally ill. And she really wasn't diagnosed at the time. So what she did was self-medicate through drugs and alcohol. And she had five children, and I was the middle of five, and we all had different dads. So here was a woman who had five kids by five different men, and was drug and alcohol addicted and mentally ill. She clearly was not capable of taking care of herself, let alone the five kids that she had. So what she would try to do is find us places to live. And we all grew up in Suffolk County, Long Island. So she would try to find us places to live throughout the county. Sometimes they would be in a home or an apartment, but we would never stay there too long until we got evicted, but we were at least able to have a roof over our head from time to time. And other times, we would be living in the back of a supermarket, out of a car, on the streets, in homeless shelters, and in foster homes as well. But when we were with our mother, when we were not in foster homes, we were basically with our mother. So she would find us these places to leave, but she would just leave us there. And because she would go off on her, alcoholic binges and her drug binges as well. So she would just leave us in these places. And so we were these five little kids who had to figure out how we were going to survive on our own. And the first priority was to figure out how to steal food to eat. So we had to be creative in how it was we were going to do that, because our goal was to make sure nobody knew how we were living and that we just basically stayed under the radar screen. So the first thing that we would do is go to a supermarket. And we would always be very thoughtful about what we needed to do before we walked in that supermarket. Everyone had a goal. There were five of us. I mean, Rosie was the littlest, so she didn't necessarily always play a role, but there was enough of us that we were able to have a decoy, and we were able to have a lookout, and we were able to have the others that were basically stealing food, and we knew what we'd be able to get based upon the season. Because if it was the summertime or fall or spring, the clothes we would be wearing would be light. So we couldn't walk in there with a big jacket. So we would know that we'd only be able to take food that we could kind of fit inside of our clothes or sometimes, in the band of our underpants. And because we had to make sure things just didn't fall down our legs. So we had to be thoughtful that way. And we were able to put things in there. Sometimes the Jiffy Muffin mix or macaroni and cheese craft, like thin things that would be able to fit in parts of our body. But other times when we needed to steal larger things, it was my job to go into the back of the supermarket and try to find what we called back then the box boys. And I would go find the box boys. They were the gentlemen tearing apart the boxes after everything was loaded on the shelf. And I would go in there and I would tell them that my father said, I had to come in here and ask for boxes because we're moving. And I was particularly want the egg boxes, the long egg cartons. So I would get two of them and put one in front inside of another. And then what I would do is I would go down the supermarket aisles and knew exactly what I would be getting. Sometimes it would be a loaf of bread or it could be English muffins. It had to be something that could fit inside and be light. So I'd lift up the one box, put the food inside, and put the top box down and kind of continue walking with it out the store. So each of us had a different role. So that's one thing that we would have to do in order to figure out how to survive. And fortunately, we were never caught when we were stealing food in a supermarket, which I have a thought about that, which I'll tell you later. And other places that we would steal food to eat were farms. Because back then, Suffolk County had significant farmland. And, vegetables, potatoes, pumpkins, lots of things in the farm. So what we would do is kind of the same thing. We would go, we'd have a decoy, we'd have a lookout. And mostly our decoy at that time when we go to a farm was our dog Pepper. So we bring Pepper and kind of let him loose. And one of the kids would go screaming, like calling for Pepper, acting as if we really didn't let him loose. And the others would be going on the ground, trying to get vegetables on the ground because we didn't want to be seen. And then we'd take off. Well, that worked for a while until one day a farmer came out with a shotgun. And we decided that we had to change our MO after that. And so another place that we would go looking for food were beaches. Because we'd love to be at beaches for a few reasons. I mean, first, we grew up on Long Island, which is a beach community. There are beaches everywhere. And second, it was kind of a place for us that we were able to meld in. And what I mean by that is that we were children who were malnutrition. No one really taught us how to blow our nose. We didn't wash often. Our hair was matted from time to time. We certainly didn't wash our clothes. I mean, if our clothes were washed, it was possibly once every few months, and it was done by hand because we didn't have money to go to a laundromat. So you can imagine what we looked like. We were pretty unkempt. And from time to time, as any child would do, you want to find other playmates, and we would go find other children and to play with. And sometimes there would be parents that would take a look at us playing with their children, and they would tell their children to stay away from us. But when we went to a beach, we didn't have to worry about that. Because you think about what a child in that situation can actually do. Sure. Because when we went to a beach, we didn't have to worry about how we looked. Because you could think about how it is that a child in that situation can easily just relieve themselves of how it is that they look at a beach. Because you take all your clothes off, except for your bathing suit. Everyone else is in a bathing suit. You go in the water, and we were able to look like every other child there. So at least for that day, we were able to play with other children, and parents weren't necessarily telling their kids to stay away from us. But we would spend days at the beach for a variety of reasons. I mean, one, it would clearly occupy our time. Two, we would always have fun there. But we could also go food shopping. Because when you went to a beach on Long Island at that point, there was a lot of seafood. And so we were able to get mussels very easily. And we went clamming with our toes. We were able to put our feet in the sand and come up with some clams as well. And we'd carry that home. And that's if we were actually had a house where we could potentially cook this. And then on the way home, we'd pick onion grass along the way, and we would use that as a spice. So these are the things that we had to do to try to figure out how to get food to stay alive. But sometimes our mother actually registered us in school. And that was a great thing, because the administration would take one look at us and realize that we had to be signed up for a free lunch. So that was a guaranteed meal for us. But what schools would also provide us was structure. And if you think about that for a child in need, who's really coming from a place that where they don't have a parent and there's no discipline and no structure, at least the public school setting was able to, we were able to get that from that setting. And not only that, but obviously we were learning, but it was basically a safe place. But there were many times where our mother didn't register us in school, or she pulled us out of school because she had a lot of warrants out for her arrest. So she was always worried about the authorities kind of tracking her down. So when she was getting nervous, she'd pull us out of school. So then we would have to find something else to do to kind of take up our time. And that's when we discovered public libraries. So we were these little kids who would go into a public library. And that for us was our place of solace. Because if you think about it from the perspective of a child in need, what a public library provided was temperature controlled. If it was, you know, cold outside, it was going to be warm in the winter. It had electricity that worked, because when you're impoverished, sometimes you can't pay your electric bill. And it had clean running water. That's another thing that many people may not have if they're impoverished. Their pipes may not be clean, and we had a lot of rusty water in the places that we lived. So just providing those three things to a child in need was key, and it was a place that we were able to stay the entire day. So we would sit there, and you know, since we were in school from time to time, obviously my older sisters learned how to read, and then they were teaching me how to read, and I was teaching my younger siblings how to read. But it was during that time in libraries that I started thinking a little bit differently about my existence. Because when I first discovered a series of books called the Landmark Series, were a series of books that were published by Random House in the 1950s, and they were made for elementary age students, and they were books of U.S. historic figures. And there were even non-U.S. historic figures, but I like reading the ones on the U.S. historic figures. And I remember only finding three books on women in the Landmark Series that were born in the U.S. One was Pocahontas, then there was Dolly Madison, and there was Betsy Ross. So I wanted to read more about these women who I thought to be very brave during challenging times. And that's when I came across Amelia Earhart and tried to read every possible book I could about Amelia Earhart. Because if you think about who she was, here was this woman who was born into an era where societal norms were defining what it was that she was supposed to be. And she was pushing against those norms, and she didn't want society to define her. She was going to define herself. So she pushed past those norms to achieve what she wanted to achieve. She wasn't going to fit into the stereotype of what a woman was supposed to be at that point. And she was gutsy, and she was fearless. And it was as I was reading this, reading about her, I started thinking about what people were telling me what my future was going to be because of the situation I was born into. because a child born into poverty with a drug and alcohol addicted mother who is dependent upon public assistance and is neglected and abandoned and homeless, statistically you're supposed to end up drug and alcohol addicted, also abusive, homeless, incarcerated, a teenage pregnant mom, or a prostitute. That's statistically what I knew at that point, that's what our destiny was going to be. Because you hear it over and over again. And when you're a street kid, you learn things a lot faster than a child who is somewhat protected would. So here I was reading these stories about Amelia Earhart and this woman who just pushed past stereotypes and defined herself. So I started thinking at a young age, maybe I could do this. Maybe I can somehow define myself. I can do what it is that I choose to do as opposed to what others tell me that I should be doing. And even though I didn't have a plan, it at least planted a seed in a very young mind. So when we were with our mother, there were times when she was there and times when she wasn't there. When she wasn't there, I described the things that we would do to try to occupy ourselves. But when she was there, it was also pretty tough because she was very abusive. And her abusiveness rose to the level of brutality that this day and age, anyone who did what she did to us, if anyone did that to their children, would be arrested and they would never get their children back. But back then, for a variety of different reasons, that didn't happen. But we still chose to stay with her. And we chose not to tell anyone how it was we were living. Because I remember by the age of 8, we were already in my siblings and I were taken away and put into a few foster homes. And when there were 5 kids in a family, they weren't kept together back then, so we were separated. So we were 5 little kids, 4 girls and a boy, and we'd be put in different foster homes. And sometimes we would have great foster parents, and other times we would have horrible foster parents. And back then they really didn't do background checks on foster parents. So bad things happened to us in foster homes. And we were separated, and we weren't able to protect each other. So what we realized at a young age is that it's better for us to deal with the devil that we knew rather than the devil we didn't know. And that's why we chose to not let anyone know how it was that we were living. So we would just start coming up with these stories. When the authorities would ask us where our mother was, we always had an answer based upon the time of day they were asking us, because she worked all these jobs. She tried to keep jobs, but she wasn't able to keep them long. But so if we were asked, if the authorities came knocking on our door at 3 in the morning, hoping to kind of catch us there without our mother, they would ask us where she was. And we would say she was delivering bread, because bakeries open up early and someone has to deliver the bread to the delis and the restaurants. And at one time she had that job and that's what she was doing. And that's the time that you do it. And when they would ask us where she was about 7 in the morning, we would say she's over at a deli and she's peeling potatoes and making potato salad because she works at a deli. And when they asked where she was during the day, we would say that she was a real estate agent. She was out trying to rent houses. And when they asked where she was at nighttime, we would tell them she was a barmaid. So we always had a story to explain why it was where she was, because we needed to be able to do that, because we never want to let anyone know how it is we were living. So even though we weren't picked up as often as we should have been picked up, we as children were complicit in this, because we kept up the story and we kept it very strongly and told it over and over again, that we started kind of believing it as well, that she was kind of out and about. And that's how we managed to live our young life, moving from place to place to place with a mother who wasn't around. And when she came home, she was abusive, but it was better than the alternative, and that was being separated. And then at the age of 11, the dynamic with the relationship with my siblings and I changed. That's because my 2 older sisters, Sherry and Camille, were 14 and 15 at that time. And they wanted to leave the home. And I'm saying that metaphorically because we really didn't have a home, but they wanted to leave. And this is very normal for teenage children growing up in this situation, kind of being street kids. After a while, the older kids spent their entire life raising the younger ones, and they want to go be teenagers. So that's what they said. They did their job. They raised me. Now it's my responsibility to raise Norman and Rosie, and they just want to go be teenagers. So they decided that they had friends and whose couches that they could sleep on, and that's what they were going to do so they can go to school and have fun and be a teenager. So there I was at the age of 11, on my own basically, because my mother wasn't around a lot, taking care of my two younger siblings. So then I was the one trying to steal the food to eat and keep our young family together. And that worked out well up until I was about right before I was turning 14. Because by that time, I was already doing it for a few years. And then from time to time, you know, my Sherry and Camille will come in and they bring food and they, you know, leave money. And they were still very much around. They just weren't living with us. But the summer before I turned 14, it was incredibly hard. And my mother was just gone for months. She found us a place to live and she was gone. And what happened during that time is I became incredibly emaciated because we didn't have enough food to feed my younger siblings and me. So whatever food we would possibly get, I would try to give to them instead of me. So, and for some reason, somewhere along the way, I realized that if I drank vinegar, it would suppress my appetite. And vinegar was great because I would get a bottle of vinegar if we had any food stamps or someone would ask us what we needed, say we need vinegar, because vinegar could like clean the house, right? Get clean your clothes a little bit. But I would also drink it and somehow would just suppress my appetite. So I was surviving on vinegar and my mother's uppers because I realized that she had uppers in one of her in her dresser drawers, and I would take them to give me energy as well to make sure as much food as possible would go to my younger siblings. So here I was, 13 years old, and I was emaciated. I was incredibly malnutritioned. I did not have all my hair. When a child doesn't have protein and is malnutrition, they start losing patches of hair. So I had bald spots around my head. And in other pieces of hair that I had, there were gray streaks at the age of 13. And so my hair wasn't, my hair clearly was a sign that something was wrong, but so was my body because I was so thin, my skin was like hanging off of my body. And my ribs you could see right through, and the skin wasn't healthy, it was a different color. But again, anyone would ask me what was going on, I wouldn't tell them because I was the one responsible for my two younger siblings. And then that changed because one day my mother came home from one of her drunken binges and she gave me a beating. And that beating was pretty brutal. Many beatings were brutal, but that particular beating was brutal, but for two reasons. One, because it was a pretty tough one, but also my body wasn't able to respond to it like it did in the past because I wasn't healthy. So I'd have these bruises and these cuts on me that kind of took on a different dimension, and I wasn't able to hide them like I did in the past. But after she left that night, I did what I usually do every single morning, is I would get up, I'd put my two younger siblings on the bus, because that's how we were going to get our meal that day, and then I got on the bus. And when I went to school, I had a teacher ask me what happened, and I didn't tell him. But clearly he could determine that something was wrong. And when I came home after school that day, I saw that there was a car in the driveway and the door was wide open, and there was a social worker inside, a caseworker inside our home. And she asked me what happened, and I said nothing. She said, something happened, look at you. And then she quickly took up my shirt where I couldn't put my arms down fast enough to protect what I didn't want her to see, and she saw a lot of marks. And then she said, you know, what happened? How did this happen? And, I told her what I always tell them. I fell down the stairs. I fell on an iron. I got in a fight with my brother. You know, the usual story that kids in that situation who don't want to tell will come up with stories about how it is that they got those bruises on them. And then she finally said to me, you've got to look at yourself and realize that you're not going to survive. And if you continue living like this, your younger siblings aren't going to survive either. You have to tell me what's going on. So we made an agreement that if I would tell her what was happening, the two things would occur. One is that I'd become emancipated. And what that means is that back then in 1980 in the state of New York, a 14-year-old can become emancipated. They can emancipate themselves from their parents. And you would do that by writing an affidavit and appearing before a judge. And I said, one is that, you know, I'd be emancipated. And the other is that I want whatever proof it is that I'm going to bring forward for my emancipation to be used against my mother to relinquish her guardianship rights over my two younger siblings, because I didn't want her to get them back either. And so she agreed that she would do that, that she would work to do that. So she left. My siblings, I put my younger siblings the next morning on the school bus. I went to school as well. And I came back at home afterwards, and I saw the worst thing that any kid in my situation could see. I saw two cars. So I walked into the house, and my mother was there with the caseworker. My younger siblings were there, and they found my older sister, Camille. And basically what happened is my two younger siblings went in one car, and we went in another, because there was no foster home that was willing to take four of us. So we were separated again. So a few days before I was 14, I was placed in this foster home. I filled out the affidavit, completed it with my sisters, and submitted it. And my mother got wind of actually what we were doing. And she realized that she wasn't even going to fight for me, because I was a lost cause. My older sisters left her. I was leaving her. But she didn't want to lose her two younger kids. And basically because they were in wheelchair. She got money for them. Every child in this particular situation is a few hundred dollars per head for the parent. So she didn't want to lose them. So as we were going forward with the emancipation, my mother went for, had a Christmas visit with my two younger siblings. Now, we were put in this home in November 6, 1980, and my mother went to go have an unsupervised visit after having two supervised visits, but an unsupervised visit with my younger siblings on December 21st, and she never brought them back. So basically what happened is she kidnapped them and brought them to Idaho. Back then, it really wasn't called kidnapping because she was a mother taking her kids out of foster care. And even though it was illegal, it's not treated how it is right now. Because if something like that happened today, you know, there'd be an Amber Alert out and people would be notified nationwide. But back then, folks looked the other way, and she ultimately basically kidnapped them and brought them across country to Idaho. So here were my older sisters and I. I mean, we were on Long Island, we were these teenage kids, and the two kids that we spent our life raising are now being taken away by the mother that we know what she's going to do to them is basically what she did to us. So we spent so long, and this is what Etched in Sand shares with you, so long fighting to try to get the state of New York to talk to the state of Idaho. And they both refused. Because the attitude by the county social services at that time was that, well, they're out of state. And so when we reached out to Idaho, you know, we were these kids who were impoverished. We were these kids who were impoverished. I'm sorry. We were kids who were impoverished, marginalized. We were in foster care. We lacked credibility. So we tried to call the Idaho Social Services and let them know what was going on and make them aware of how my mother was and how she was going to act. And basically, when they finally reached out to her, she would tell them, oh, don't listen to Regina. The reason why she's in foster care is because she's a juvenile delinquent and she's an alcoholic and she's promiscuous. And they would buy her word. So as opposed to the fact that maybe there's legitimacy to what I'm going to say, but because of who I was, I lack credibility. So they did nothing either. So here's the state of New York and the state of Idaho that are refusing to correspond with each other, and the state of Idaho is not taking us seriously. So we were these teenage girls stuck in Suffolk County while our siblings were somewhere else, and we didn't know what to do. So still, while we were trying to figure out how to contact them, how to find out how they were doing, we still had to move ahead with our lives. So we did that. And that's what Etched in Sand shows you as well, is how we managed to move ahead with our lives, still while we were fighting for them. So here I was in this foster home by myself. And I was emancipated. And after I was emancipated, my caseworker said to me, you know, when you turn 18, you're going to age out of foster care. And you're probably going to be homeless, so you have to figure out, like, how you're not going to be homeless. Because I didn't have a parent. I didn't have anyone who would take me in. So I said, well, really? Well, I'm emancipated now, and I'm freed for adoption. Won't someone want to adopt me? And she said, no, no one wants to adopt foster kids, especially older foster kids. So she started giving me independent living training to teach me how to not be homeless at the age of 18. So this is what the independent living training was at that point. It was a checklist that had a lot of questions on it. And she would ask me the questions, and if I knew the answer, she would check the box, and that was the extent of the independent living training. So the first question was whether or not I knew how to pay the rent. And I said, well, you know, I can figure it out. I haven't had to pay rent, but I think I could figure it out. If I make money, then I've got to pay this bill once a month. And then the second question was, well, do you know how to call the local power company to put the lights on in your apartment? And I said, well, I've gotten enough calls from the power company every time they want to shut the lights off, so I'm pretty sure I can figure out how to do it the other way. And then another question was, well, do you know how to go food shopping? I was like, with or without money? But that's basically it. That was the independent living skills that I was giving at this young age to prepare me to be on my own at the age of 18. But fortunately, I was going to a high school where there were wonderful teachers who spent as much time as possible with me, trying to put me in as many AP classes as they could, and putting me on the path to college. And they were the ones who told me, and it was two of them specifically, and I mentioned them in the book, that kept telling me the only way out of your situation is an education, and the only way out of poverty is for you to go to college. And they kept drilling that in my head for the 4 years that I was there. And one of them particularly would make sure I would be in his classes all the time, because he would teach a lot of classes in different grades. And so he would pay special attention to me, making sure I was moving forward. And so I would go back to my caseworker and I would tell her, oh, don't worry about me being homeless at 18, I'm gonna go to college. And she said, no, you won't. But I said, what do you mean, I'm gonna go to college? She's like, no, you can't afford it. You're not gonna be able to live on your own. How are you gonna pay for this? And I said, well, I'm gonna go to college. My teachers told me I'm gonna go to college. And she said, no, foster kids actually go to college. And you know, she was right. Because this day and age, only 2% of the foster care population in the U.S. actually get a college degree. Back then, it was a lot less. So she was right. But I didn't listen to her. I listened to my teachers, the ones who encouraged me and built up my self-worth. And that's the direction I ended up going. So then ultimately, I went to college and went away. But while all of this was happening again, I was still trying to do my best to protect my younger siblings. We figured out ways to communicate with them, figured out codes. I found the addresses of their friends' homes, and we would mail them stuff there, and that's how we'd mail letters back and forth so my mother wouldn't find out. Once in a while, we'd send them a birthday card at the house where they would live with my mother, and they knew that to not just look at the card, but to open it up, because if you open up a birthday card, you can kind of unglue it, and it's really it's a square. And we would paste money and things in there, and we'd paste it back up and put it in and then send it on their way. So my mother wouldn't find out what was in the cart to kind of give them money. And when she found that out, then that's when we started mailing them stuff at their friend's house. So we kind of figured out ways to kind of to stay in touch, because it was the 1980s and we didn't have email or anything else, and all we had was a phone on the wall. And so calling our phone to their phone was tough, because my mother was around there often. So as my sisters and I moved forward, I went on to college, and I started at a much larger university than I ended up in. And I realized when I went into this large university that I wasn't prepared for it. Because here I was, this kid without an infrastructure or a safety net or a foundation. And I was in a college with classes of 250 to 1,000 students as a freshman. And I wasn't able to figure out or navigate it at all. So I decided to go away to college. And so I transferred away to SUNY New Paltz, as you know, it's not too far north of here, for two primary reasons. I mean, one is because they had an education major, and as any woman growing up on Long Island, you want to spend your summer at the beaches. So I thought, well, this will be perfect. But the real reason why is because eight of my friends from high school transferred there. I mean, were going there. And at least if I went there, I would have community. Remember, at the larger university, I didn't have community. So I went there at least to have community and have somewhat of a safety net, because at least I would know people there and I was friends with people there, so it wouldn't be so isolated. Because as a foster kid going through this type of a situation, they don't have a place to go back to during the holidays. They don't have a place to go back to during intercession. And they feel isolated. They're working. I had to work several jobs at once to try to make money to kind of get through. Plus, you've got to get through your classes. So it was important that I at least didn't feel so isolated there. Anyway, so I transferred away to college. I thought I was going to be an education major. I signed up for that the semester I transferred away, which was the second semester of my sophomore year. And I had to take a history class. I mean, there's a requirement in education to take a history class. And the only class that fit into my schedule that would classify, or was determined to be a potential history class, was an 8 a.m. class with Professor Brownstein on international politics. And I accidentally signed up for it. Because I don't think any 19-year-old in their right mind would sign up for an 8 a.m. international politics class. And when I found out Professor Brownstein's reputation, I realized, why many people wouldn't sign up for it. Anyway, so I walked into class, and you know, the first day of class, he started, you know, asking us if we're all registered to vote, if we're reading the New York Times, if we've read the President's State of the Union. I mean, you can imagine the minds going on in this class, thinking, okay, how quickly can I withdraw from it? But I stuck it out because something about him I found appealing, and I started learning right away. And this is what I learned in this class. I learned what baby Doc Duvalier was doing to the people of Haiti and why he was pushed out. I learned what the dictator Marcos was doing to his people in the Philippines and how he kept all the resources from them. I learned about conflicts that were going on in the Middle East at that time, which are still going on this time. They just have a different name. And I learned how women were living in the Middle East and how women were treated. And then he had us learn about Africa and all the different countries there and the lack of healthcare systems in certain countries. And for the first time in my 19 years, I actually felt that I was lucky. Because I realized by learning how these other people live in these other countries that if my siblings and I were born into the situation we were born in with a mother who abandoned us in any of these other countries, we wouldn't have survived. We would have been sold into the sex trade, we would have been child warriors, or we wouldn't have survived because of a poor healthcare system. And so, but here I was, a 19-year-old kid who was abandoned and homeless for many years in her young life and was in foster care now. I was sitting in a college classroom. So for the first time, I actually started realizing how lucky I was because all of the resources that were made available to me as a child, which includes the public library system, the public school system, public assistance for those who are desperately in need of it. And here I was in a publicly subsidized college as well. And that's why I was there. So that's why I started thinking differently again about my life. Remember that aha moment I told you about Amelia Earhart? Well, here I was again, now realizing I've got so much around me that I just have to figure out how to take advantage of it with all these resources that are out there. So I started being more optimistic about what my future was because I really didn't have a plan before then. And something else I also learned in that class and my other political science classes, because ultimately I quickly changed my major to political science, because as hard as that class was, I did get the lowest grade that semester in that class, but I learned the most from it. And that's why I realized that I have to continue with these studies. So then I learned what the definition of politics is. The definition of politics is the allocation of resources. And if you think about what that means, right, who runs politics? Whoever's in the head, whether it's the president or the governor or a county executive or a mayor, they're the ones in charge. And that's why people fight so hard to have those positions, because once you get into that position, you're in charge of the resources and you get to allocate them. That's what it means. Politics is the allocation of resources. So whoever gets to the top is the one who can figure out where these resources are going to go. So then I started thinking, who are these people? And how have they made these decisions about what resources are going to be available for my siblings and I? So then I started thinking, you know what, one day, maybe I can be in charge of those resources. And then I just had a goal. I was going to go down this path of public advocacy. And so that's what Etch and Sand does. It actually shows you the story of these kids who lived on the fringe of society, were completely marginalized, had very little resources, but we were optimistic, We were tremendously resilient, and we were incredibly tenacious. And with that, we pulled ourselves up and out. And it shows you in Etch and Sand why and how we actually did it. So I'll fast forward to the end. So just a few years ago, I was practicing law in the private sector, and very happily I was there for a long time. And a friend of mine ran for county executive in Suffolk County. And Suffolk County is a significant, it's a pretty large county. It has 1.5 million residents, a $2.7 billion budget, and a workforce of 9,500 people. So it's large. In fact, there are 12 states in the U.S. that are smaller than that by the capacity I just described. So he ran for county executive and he won. And he took me out for coffee shortly after, and he said, you know, I'd like you to be my chief deputy. And I said, are you kidding me? Chief deputy to Suffolk County. I said, you want me to be the chief deputy of the county that I grew up homeless in? He said, absolutely. And I thought, who has access to the resources now? So of course I accepted it. What a wonderful opportunity to help manage a county where I grew up dependent upon it. I've got a completely different perspective than many others who would have that position. So I took it. And within the first 2 weeks, I was able to do something that was quite rare, because within the first 2 weeks of anyone getting a job, usually you think you know what you're doing when you're going in, you do your best to transition in, but the ultimate goal is to just figure out how to put the lights on, how to put the computer on, and where the bathroom is, right? I mean, let's, you know, as far as being there that long. So the first 2 weeks into the office, I was handed a copy of Newsday, which is our paper on Long Island. And there's a picture of a young woman on the cover. Her name is Samantha Garvey. And Samantha was nominated to be an Intel semifinalist. But there were many children on Long Island, many students who were nominated to be Intel semifinalists. But what was so special about her is that she was living in a homeless shelter with her parents and her two younger twin siblings. And the story was about how she never gave up on her education and what a disciplined student she was. And she knew that this is what was going to lift her up and out of poverty. And her parents fell upon hard times, but she wanted to be a role model to her younger siblings. And I realized that they needed a place to stay. So we got all the commissioners together and the different agencies in the county. And I said, well, what can we do? And they said, well, we have 5 houses in the county, and 4 of them that the county owns for subsidized housing, and 4 of them families live in it. And I said, well, what about the 5th? Well, the 5th is, it's destroyed on the inside. The last person that lived there really destroyed it. And I said, I asked, is there a waiting list? And they said, no, because we need to renovate the house so we don't have a waiting list. And I said, but you have a house. And they said, well, it's pretty bad inside. I said, but you have a house. So from the perspective of a homeless kid living in a shelter versus a house, it doesn't have to be perfect. It could just be a house. And at least it's a place for her to be and her siblings to be and her family to be together where they're not dealing with the pressures of living in this homeless shelter. I said, so what can we do to get this house fixed up? And everyone put their minds to it, and they figured out that we were going to be able to renovate it within 2 weeks. All the workers that were going to work on it in the county agreed that if they worked overtime, they weren't going to charge it. Like, everyone was kind of getting on board with this. It was announced the next day, and so Steve, my boss, went out and had a press conference and announced what we were doing and saying we were going to give her and her family this subsidized house, and it was going to be renovated. And as soon as we did that, everyone came out of the woodwork, literally, all puns intended, to offer up floors and roof and free labor in the bathrooms. I mean, people were coming from all around the community to help her. And after we announced it, Sam went off, because everyone wanted to invite her and wanted to meet her. She met with President Obama. She went on the Ellen DeGeneres show. She gave her a $50,000 scholarship to go to college. She came back. We gave her the house. I thought at that point, public service can never get any better than this. I knew I had to go ahead and help Steve run the county from day to day, but I thought maybe this was the reason why I was asked to do this job, so I could have this one opportunity to give this young woman something that wasn't given to me, but I know how powerful it could be to kind of propel her forward and propel her younger siblings forward. So that made sense to me. And so we were just plugging along, you know, running the county operations from on day to day. But then all of a sudden, in October of that year, our county was hit by Superstorm Sandy. And we had hundreds of families that were now without homes. And it was my responsibility to help get these newly homeless families homes, which was ironic because I was to do this in the county where I grew up homeless. So that's what Etched in Sand is about. It's a story about, again, resilience and optimism and tenacity, but learning to harness all the resources that are out there. And our effort, my siblings and I, our effort to break the cycle in one generation of everything, of drug and alcohol abuse, of homelessness, of public assistance dependency, of abuse, and which we did. And so it's a fabulous story that has really had a tremendous impact. And my siblings and I, you know, when I started writing the book, there was a bit of apprehension. And after the manuscript was written, when they read it, they realized how beautiful it was. And they thought, you know what, maybe, you know, maybe this may help just a few people. So they were all on board with us publishing it. So I'm going to tell you the two reasons why I wrote the book. The first is because of all those kids out there who are dealt bad hands. Because in the U.S., as many resources as we have, there are still children who are in need. I mean, first, there's over 400,000 children in foster care every year in the U.S., and 26,000 of them age out to nobody but themselves at the ages of 18 or 21. And statistically, because they age out to no one but themselves, they're basically let out on this earth with very few resources. And that's why a lot of them end up homeless or incarcerated, because half our homeless population are former foster youth, and a third of our incarcerated population are former foster youth. Because when these kids age out without any resources, they get desperate and they make mistakes, and that's how they end up in the situations that they end up in. And so I've been working with an organization called You Gotta Believe to try to get older foster kids adopted and to give people a different perspective of what a foster child is that they're not a bad kid. They actually were just dealt a bad hand. And but with all the work that we're doing, we know that all the foster kids out there are not going to be adopted, and many of them are just going to be on their own. So they're one of the reasons why I wrote the book. But there's also millions of kids out there who may well have parents and living with a parent or parents, but they're impoverished, they're neglected, and they're wondering why it is that they were dealt the hand that they were dealt, as opposed to looking at how others live and wondering why they weren't born into that situation. So that's the first reason why I wrote the book, is really to hopefully reach out to those kids and to show them that, yes, you were dealt a bad hand. Many of us here in the U.S. were dealt bad hands. But if you believe in your inner light and you have self-determination, there are enough resources out there. You just have to learn how to harness them, and you can pull yourself up and out. But I also try to give them a realistic perspective of how difficult it is in Etched in Sand, because we didn't have a parent helping us. So when you don't have a parent and you have no foundation, it takes you a lot longer to pull yourself up and out than it does somebody actually who does have a parent. So I wanted to show them how it was done and that it could be done. And I also wrote a little message for them in the book where I talk about how every day when I was in college and I was there as up at SUNY New Paltz, I was working three jobs at once. And I was doing it for myself, but I also kind of felt in a way maybe I was doing it for my siblings too, because I was a first generation college student. But it was very isolating and dark because I was on my own basically trying to figure out how to get a college education. But I said I would wake up every day and I'd make a promise to myself that I would get out of bed, I put one foot in front of another, and I get through that day and achieve the goals that I had to achieve by that day. And once I did that, I was a day closer to my goal. So I was just showing them, don't make big goals. Don't shoot for the stars. Set milestones. Because once you get to that milestone, then you could breathe and figure out what your next step is going to be. And that's exactly how I did it. There were no big goals that I had, because when you're in that situation and you don't have a safety net, you can't even imagine actually achieving them. And you would set yourself up to fail rather than setting yourself up to reach a goal that's a bit more moderate. The second reason why I wrote the book is because of all of you that are here. I wouldn't have been able to pull myself up and out if it wasn't for others around me. Because as Jennifer had mentioned earlier, it was there was a community, and we would somehow build community even though we would move and we were transient kids. If you think about my life, I moved from place to place to place. So I was in and out of school districts, I was in and out of libraries, I was in and out of different places when I even wasn't registered in school, and I never had one adult in my life for a long time. But I had good adults. What I mean by that is in my book, I talk about how adults interacted with me as a child. And those who interacted with us negatively, I changed their names in the book because it wasn't about calling them out. It was just to remind people the impact that an adult can have on a child in need for that moment in time when they're before them and how adversely it could actually impact that child. But then in my book, all those who were kind to me, I put their real names in there because they deserve to be recognized for the impact that they actually had, even though I was before them for a moment in time. So I call them good touches and bad touches. And I happen to have more good touches in my life than bad touches. And they varied. They were momentary, but they accumulated and made a difference. I mean, one of them, as a foster child, you go from home to home to home or place to place with a garbage bag. And you don't have a lot in the garbage bag. You have some clothes, but you also have possessions. Because these kids have no history and no connections, and they're trying to hold on to whatever history that they have about them. So I had a few things in my garbage bag. I had two baby Jesuses, a picture of my siblings and I when we were younger, which is, we finally took another one about 40 years later. So it's the only picture of the five of us when we were little. And I had a fifth grade autograph book, which I still have today. But these baby Jesuses, they came from like little haystacks from a nativity scene. I would walk around with them. I never knew where I actually got them from, but I know whoever gave them to me loved me. And I would think about the person who gave them to me, and I didn't know who it was, but I remember being well-fed and loved. So I held on to those baby Jesuses because this person really loved me, and I really wasn't loved as a baby, so I held on to those baby Jesuses. Spoiler alert for anyone who didn't read the book yet, I actually find out in chapter 10, who gave me the baby Jesuses, in my 30s. But then I also had this fifth grade autograph book, and it was from, I went to the fifth grade in St. James Elementary School, and by that time, when I went back to St. James, a lot of bad things had happened to me, and I didn't feel particularly pretty. And I had this fifth grade teacher, Ms. Vandover, who would constantly tell me how pretty I was. And I know I didn't look it, and I certainly didn't feel it. And she not only would tell me that, but she would tell me I was smart, and I was talented, and build up my self-worth, and encourage me. And every week, she would have a spelling bee. And I was convinced she had these spelling bees for me, because I would win them every single week, except for the last one. And the winner of the spelling bee, the prize would be a ring ding or a Twinkie. So I was convinced she was having them so she could feed me, because I would win all the time. But at the end of the year, she wrote in my fifth grade autograph book the things that she would tell me during the year. So I held on to this book, and I still have it today, because when I would feel terrible or I would, you know, someone would insult me or put me down, I'd go back in this book and I'd read what Ms. Vandover told me, and I would say, but if Ms. Vandover told me that, what they're saying can't be true. And these were examples of accumulated touches. I mean, another one was how parents would react to me playing with their children. Some of them would tell their child to stay away from me. But others would take one look at me playing with their child, and they would tell their child to invite me home. So when I went back to their house, whether it was for a few hours or a night or a weekend, I would get a bath or a shower, if that was appropriate, if I was staying there a while. I would get fed. I would get my clothes cleaned. But the most important thing I actually took away from their homes was I learned what a healthy home environment was. Because remember, I didn't have it. So that was another good touch. So you think about all these people along the way that actually made a difference. They were accumulated good touches that replaced having a parent or an infrastructure there. And it added up. Because for that moment in time as a transient child, when I was before these people, they were doing everything they possibly could, never knowing how I was going to turn out, but did what they could to actually make a difference in my life. And that's the second reason why I wrote the book, is to remind you of the power that you have for that moment in time when a child is in need is before you. They are looking for positive reinforcement from adults around them because they're not getting it from other places. And they will remember how you interact with them, and it's going to stay with them. And if you could do what you possibly could for that moment in time to be kind and to care for them, it's going to make a difference. Because all we could possibly do, because we can't control where it is that they're going to move on to next, but all we could possibly do is that for that moment in time and just hoping they move on, that someone else is going to do the same thing for them. And that's one of the reasons, the second reason why I wrote the book, is that one of the messages that readers are actually getting from it that has really taken off. Etched and Sand came out in August of 2013. And, when the book first came out, it hit the New York Times bestseller list for 2 weeks. I was very happy. It got a lot of press around it. People like rags to riches stories, so there was some good press. And then it fell off the list, and I was okay, because my goal was, when I wrote this book, among a variety of other things, to make sure it wasn't going to be the worst seller. So I achieved that. All right, done. And then press went away because they move on to the next book or movie that's coming out. And maybe about 5 or 6 months later, I saw there was such momentum with the book because I was still getting contact from people every day. I mean, I have a Facebook page, a website, and a Facebook author page that are all my first and last name. So it's very easy for people to find me because there's only one other Regina Calcaterra in the world, and she lives in Argentina. And she's blonde and in her 20s. So they would realize whose Facebook page is what. So people would send me messages, and I would be learning how the book is actually impacting them. So that momentum of messages would continue. The book was selling. I was being asked to speak still, far after the book came out. And I was wondering where this was all coming from. And my publisher from HarperCollins called me in May and said, "You're not going to believe it, but your book is back on the New York Times bestseller list." And it remained on the list, this was just this past spring and summer, for 14 weeks in a row, and rose to number two weeks in a row, right behind Maya Angelou. And the reason why this happened is because people like you who read the book and are telling others about the book, there was this tremendous word of mouth that was spreading about Etched in Sand and the messages that are in there. And it showed in the people who were contacting me. I mean, I would get messages from caseworkers around the world and even in Australia who read the book and said, "I wonder why I do what I do every day and whether it's making an impact. But after reading Etched in Sand, I realize if I don't get up and I don't go to work and I don't do this, there's going to be kids who aren't going to be affected by my interaction. And I may never know how it is that they turn out. But now I realize I don't have to know. All I have to know is when they're before me for that moment that I do everything I possibly could." Then I had teachers and principals writing me from across the nation. And one of them is from West Virginia, and she's a teacher, a principal in a rural area where they have, poverty and transient children. And she said there's always a discussion that she has with her other teachers about whether or not these kids who come in and out of their schools, for a few days or for a few weeks are a lost cause. And she wrote me and she said, "After reading Etched in Sand, we all realize that no child is a lost cause." And that's what I'm hearing from educators as well. And then I hear from people who just read the book and try to figure out, that are not educators and not caseworkers, and try to figure out what to do. I had one thing on Long Island, it was amazing, is there is a food shelter that has been around there for 31 years in one of the towns I lived in St. James. It wasn't there when I was younger. And they've had a rule in place that only an adult could come in and get food. So they had children coming in for the 31 years asking for food for their family, and they turned them away. So the woman who ran the shelter said after she read my book, she realized the mistake that they were making. She said, "These kids walked here, and we turned them away because they needed like a letter from their parent, or their adult a parent had to be present, and we realized they're probably never going to get that. So she changed the rules there, that any time a child comes in, regardless of age, they ask for food for a family of five, give them a family of food for a family of five. So she has now been sharing that with other pantries on Long Island and telling them to just be aware and to think about, you know, revisiting that rule that they had. Then I have had a woman contact me who was trying to figure out what to do, and she realized that nearby is a low-income community and she had some extra cash. So since she's read Etched in Sand on a weekly basis, she's been giving this deli that serves this low-income community money. And she said every time a youngster or even a teenager or a young adult comes in and they look hungry, please take this money and pay for their food. These are what people are doing. And then just two other examples. One of them is, I know we have some folks here from CASA tonight. Can I see the folks from CASA? There we go. CASA is an organization called the Court-Appointed Special Advocates, and they are a group of volunteers who don't necessarily have a child welfare background, but they're trained to represent a child in the courtroom. And what that means is that they go through training, and so this child will have someone representing them. And so people are reading my book and realizing that the one thing that we didn't have was a voice, and no one really acted on our best interest. So then they go online and they try to put in words, you know, voice for children, and they come up with CASA. So I've had readers nationwide write me that after they've read my book, they try to figure out what to do. They found out about this organization called CASA, and they're now volunteering for it. And the beauty of CASA is that one child is assigned to each worker, so that worker gets to know the child as much as possible, so the child's rights are really, really represented, and their voice is heard in the courtroom. So that's a wonderful gift I've been able to give to CASA because of the great organization and the work that it does. But I'm just going to tell you about one more profound interaction I've had, and we'll open it up to Q&A. And I know that we're running late, and we're probably going to have, yeah, the gospel singing in a moment. But I was in Massachusetts at a book club. There were lots of people there who read the book. And the only person who didn't was the husband of the homeowner. And after everyone left that night, he came over to me, and he was crying. And he said, he has to tell me something, and he was very upset. His face was wet, and he was upset. And he said, I have a 16-year-old son. I said, I know, because I saw that there was a teenage boy there. And he said, well, in our community, there is a family who the parents are drug and alcohol addicted, and their house isn't well kept, and they have a 16-year-old son. So I have told my son to stay away from that boy. And in fact, everyone else in our community has done the same thing. And he said, I didn't realize what we were doing. That we have had the opportunity to give this young man choices and options, and we haven't, because we instinctively thought he's going to turn into a statistic, and we've pushed him there. So he told me what he was going to do. The next day he was going to go out and engage this young man. He was going to ask his son to engage this young man, and he said, I'm going to talk to everyone here too, how we can make a difference in his life and how much we've been hurting him by our interactions. So it's such a blessing for my siblings and I to actually have to take a story that could be deemed as a tragic childhood and actually shared it in a way that has had such an impact on readers and on other lives as well. So I thank you for being here tonight. I thank you for listening, and I thank for those who have read the book for reading it and for sharing it as well. So I know time is brief, but we have booksellers outside, but of course I do want to get to some Q&A, so we'll do it until I start hearing the choir in the back, which may be 5 minutes.
Two or three questions.
Then we'll go, great. And then what I'm going to do is, when you ask a question, I'm going to repeat it to make sure everyone else here heard it. So let's, right there, take a question. Yes. First, I'll answer the one that doesn't have a good outcome. We have no interaction with any of our fathers. Some of us don't know who they actually are. One of them was killed, I mentioned in the book. right after Rosie was born. Her father was killed a few years after that. And although I have met my father one time after I brought the litigation against him, I have no interaction with them. And, you know, we're all better off, because if there were people that brought us into the world and didn't want anything to do with us and we had to struggle the way that we struggled, it's better for us to be around folks who are supportive and who support children just generally than those who don't. So, you know, mine is a choice. My other siblings, there are different reasons, but they're not there. But how are my siblings doing? They are doing absolutely amazing. I am an aunt of 12 nieces and nephews. So they have, within one generation, actually, I am an aunt of 12 nieces and nephews, and I'm actually now a great aunt too, because my sister Camille's oldest son has had a little boy. And so my siblings have brought into this world 12 kids that will never suffer how we suffer, and these children are made amazingly compassionate and caring, and some of them have been Christian missionaries in foreign countries like Kenya and Uganda, and one of my nephews is still there. So it's amazing how we've managed to cut the cycle, and then they brought in the next generation that have learned from our experiences and are giving back in a way that we would have never imagined. So they're doing absolutely wonderful. Thank you. Another question? Take one or two more. Yes. I had an aunt, it's in the book, and don't want to give it all away, but an aunt and uncle on my father's side who wanted to keep me, my two older sisters and I, except social services at that time said no, because there was no such thing as kinship care, meaning in foster care, sometimes it's preferred that you don't put a child in a foster home with strangers, that you put them with a family member. And that's called kinship care. So that wasn't a concept at that time. So those that did want to keep us and raise us, we were taken from them, and they didn't hear from us until decades later, because we really didn't know that each other existed. And on my mother's side, no, they didn't have it either. She didn't. But you know, she was drug and alcohol addicted. She had five kids. She was constantly asking them for things. So at a certain point, they kind of felt that they were enabling her. So there was a bit of that dynamic that was going on there. But this day and age, through all the contacts that are out there and the social media, it's a lot easier to kind of find family who would be more willing to have taken us if we had that access. One more question, and then we'll go.
On your website and your Facebook page, is it interactive?
Yes. Yes. Well, they're communicating with me because either they message me to send me a private message, which I get all the time, on it, or they're posting something on my page, or I will post something and then people will post back, and then I'll interact back with them there. That's it's my name. I don't have a card, but it's Regina Calcaterra. Okay. Thanks. Yeah. So it's So it's on both of those, and my website. I have a email that's on there, and then you could send me an email also. Okay, great. All right, so I think we'll wrap it up and we'll go outside for the book signing. Thank you so much again for being here, especially the students.
I hope the book is at every library you studied in as a little girl.